Thank you very much. Thank you to Cara and the team for inviting me here. It's really nice to speak to a crowd of people that aren't necessarily security people. So when I was asked to come and speak here, albeit I have 10 or 12 minutes, I thought, what can I try and say to a room of people that aren't security people, and what can I try and explain about some of my learnings? So I thought I'd come up with my three steps to successful product security. I got absolutely slated by Matt for that picture earlier on, so cheers, Matt. I thought that came to me at 2 o'clock yesterday afternoon. I thought, that's genius. If one person gets it, then great. So some disclaimers, in case you hadn't noticed, if you don't know who I am. I like memes, so this is a meme fest, if everyone can see. And I'm not an expert. We bandy these terms around in our industries, and I'm none of those things. I'm just somebody who happens to have worked for a few companies, and I've learned quite a lot over the last sort of 6-7 years. I've also failed quite a lot. So I like to give these talks and kind of explain some of the stuff that I've done. So yeah, I'm not a thought leader or an expert, if that's unless LinkedIn says so. So I normally do a little bit on who I am and my journey. I'm going to do less of that just from a time point of view, but these are some of the companies I've worked for in security. I was also at RBS for a long time. So Skyscanner was where I learned my trade, I think, from a security point of view. And I went to Capital One for a little while. I'm at Photobox just now. I'm actually about to just leave Photobox to go to Just Eat and head up their cloud security at Just Eat. So these companies can be reasonably similar. They're high transactional e-commerce kind of websites and mobile apps. Some of the journey's been incredibly interesting, Skyscanner especially, because when I joined, there was only me and one other person in security. And I think now it's about 19, 20 people. So the progression from, and they were not a startup when I joined them, there were 600 people there. So sometimes there aren't a huge amount of security people at even well-established companies. This is the best quote that I've ever seen. It's not mine, it's not my work, it never is. This is the best quote I've ever read on security, so I thought I'd add it into this presentation. Security culture is what employees do when the security team isn't looking. If we're trying to embed cultures into businesses, if we don't have to then go and do anything, and the security is already being done, whether that's baked into the product or in various other ways, then that feels like success to me. So if you're building any products or you're in businesses that are trying to embed security culture, that's the holy grail to try and get to. So my step one. Somebody said on Twitter that I'd removed the two best looking steps out of that picture. It felt a bit harsh. So step one, designing for security. I guess there's a lot of people in the room who are part of companies that deal with the designing of product. Now, you do design reviews, right? I'm sure that's part of your everyday role. Do you do threat modeling as part of that? Has anybody in the room done any threat modeling? That's more than I was expecting. that's cool. I would encourage any of the companies you work for, if you're doing design reviews, to think about threat modeling. It's a similar premise to design reviews. These are the four questions that you ask yourself when you do threat modeling. I wish I had more time to go into real specifics, but maybe it's for another time. What are we building? So have a, when you're putting kind of architecture diagrams or data flows together, what is it that you're trying to build? And then fundamentally, what can go wrong? What are the threats? In all of those things that you're building, what could potentially go wrong? And you don't just, you can threat model anything. You could threat model your house. You could threat model a city. I've seen the threat model of a city before, where can things go wrong in when you build those things? And then what are you going to do about it? And the answer to some of that might be, I'll do nothing. We'll accept it as a risk and we'll move on. But you also might implement lots of controls in lots of areas to deal with those things. And then afterwards, did we do a good job? Or have we been hacked? Or have we been breached? Or has there been an incident off the back of that? So threat modeling to me, please go and read up about it. It's really valuable. There's not a lot of security teams doing it at the moment, so it is quite new. OWASP, those four questions came from OWASP, which is the Open Web Application Security Project. It's probably the largest open source community for application security on the internet. I'd encourage you to go and have a look at who they are. There are hundreds of sites that they put together for all aspects of security. API, applications, incident response, you name it. So step two, so you've designed your product, you're ready to go, you're gonna build it, you're gonna code it. What are the things you can do after that? So For me, it's about building secure code. Easier said than done, and it's the bread and butter of kind of what I do in a day job. First off, code reviews. And I think the important thing about code reviews, and I hope everybody does a code review when they build things, is that if you do a secure code review, you don't have to consider everything. Not everything within your code is going to need a security review. So have a think about things like authentication and authorization. Perhaps you're building a mobile app that requires a login from a customer. I would naturally do a security code review around that part of that code. If you're handling sensitive data, I think some of the chat before about compliance and what we do with data, that would be an area that I would consider for a secure code review. Then we get onto the cooler stuff, right? Because who wants to sit and review code all day? Automated testing. You can use tooling. You could build it yourself. There's probably plenty of things on the market that you can use to help with. But there are things that you can use to do automated testing of your code to complement a code review potentially. I think one of the challenges, especially that I've found in the businesses where I've tried to implement these things, is that you're not to affect the speed of delivery. If I was to make a code delivery go from an hour to a day, I'd be out of a job. So it's finding that middle ground of what works for you. And then secrets management. I've lost count of the amount of incidents and things that I see and have potentially dealt with in the companies I've been with where you find leaked keys in, you know, personal GitHub accounts and all sorts of really, really silly stuff. Don't write your own custom crypto because it's already been done really well by other people. It's only going to end badly if you try and write your own custom crypto. I used to have a meme for that. I didn't manage to put it in there, funnily enough. And then encrypt all the things. I know that's a bit of a catch-all phrase, but if you've got the option to encrypt something, why would you not do it? So think about making that choice. A lot of the tooling these days and the infrastructure allows you to do that very, very easily. AWS, for example. You don't really have to think about it. So that's number two. I'm kind of rushing through this, which is good because we've only got 10 minutes. But step three. So you've built your product. And it's good to go, and you've released it to the market, and you're now all millionaires, or your company's been acquired, or doing really well. So what might you want to support from a security aspect? And again, this is not exhaustive, but just a few things to think about. I think that if the one thing you can take away from this rush talk today is an incident process, whatever that looks like, if you have a way of dealing with a security incident, that's probably the best you can do if you're not doing the other stuff. And that might be simple things like playbooks that say, if something bad happens, who do I need to go and speak to? If we get breached, what teams do I need to go and contact? Do I need to speak to my PR team, my legal team? Knowing how to deal with a data breach, whether you're a large company or a small company, is really difficult to kind of build those things and do them. Test your app. So numerous ways you can do this. Hopefully you've done all the testing before you've put it live and you're confident that it's as good as you can make it and it's as risk-free as you can make it. There's ways and means that you can test your apps once they've gone live. So pen testing is the more traditional old school way. It's a a moment in time test of either an application or part of your infrastructure. Bug bounties, that's something I've been involved in and quite public about speaking about them. They are crowdsourced pen tests. That happens all the time. Great for internet sites and mobile applications and the companies that I've worked for. And then if you're really cool and you're really advanced, you do red teaming, which is where you have individuals within your own company who go and hack your applications for you, all legally, of course. A third, training and learning, trying to embed that security culture, which I mentioned in that quote from the start. One of the things that I found really valuable over the last few years is a gamification of that. I've tried to chuck security courses over to engineers and it's just fallen flat on its arse. Gamifying things seems to have a really positive effect on not just engineering teams, but your wider business, because it's more fun, it's funky. It's not, you know, death by PowerPoint. So again, there's lots of good blogs about that. I'm happy to put some stuff out on Twitter later that I've found that's really good. So what have I learned? This is probably more generic as opposed to some things on product security. Your journey has to start somewhere. As I said, I've worked for organizations where I've been pretty much the only security person that we've then grown teams and built processes. So you've got to start somewhere, even if it's with the very, very basics, and then you want to drive it forward. Implementing it is hard. It takes real graft. It's painful. This is the most rewarding job I've ever done in my career, but it's also the hardest. People repeat mistakes. We're real fail fast environments. But we repeat mistakes, so I think we need to find a way to make that better, whether it's by automating things or taking the human out of the equation. Security is hard and often complex. I've moved into cloud security these days over the last year or so, and that's a microcosm of security as a whole. It's really, really difficult. I'm not just saying that with my imposter syndrome hat on. It's the most difficult thing I've ever done because there's so many facets to it. So going in with the understanding that it's going to be difficult probably sets you up for success. And recruitment, I've said this a lot in recent talks, if you don't have the people to help you, you're not going to get to where you need to be. So recruitment's the hard. Well, it's the best thing I do in my career. It's the hardest thing I do in my career, but it's the most valuable for the businesses that we work for. So thank you very much. I'm looking forward to questions afterwards. Thank you.